Are you ready?
Amen.
Amen. Oh, phew. Are you ready?
Amen.
You are not ready?
So we're looking at the whole chapter
but we'll just start to consider about the vine and the branches. You know, there's a maze. Have you ever seen a maze where the bushes and there's a pathway through it, but we can easily get lost in that maze? And sometimes we can feel like that in life. Sometimes we can lose our direction of where we're supposed to be going or what we're supposed to be doing. And that direction that gets lost is because we take our eyes off Christ. Because somewhere we're putting our eyes on something else. And this message, I hope, helps us to focus on getting our direction right. Angus Bertram said, "Our circumstances must not determine our relationship with Jesus." Here in South Africa, we are facing many challenges right now. I'm a farmer going through the worst drought in 200 years, but that doesn't change my hope in Jesus. Amen. So it doesn't matter what difficulties are going on in your life. It doesn't matter whatever you're facing. We've got to keep our eyes on Jesus. And that's the secret of keeping direction. Ray Miller said, "I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather buy his than have riches or toll. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands. And that's what Christ wants you and I to have. We get lost because we're seeking things that's not Christ. And we have to seek Christ first. "Then at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, of things in heaven and things in earth, then under the earth, that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Philippians 2, 10, 11. Paul sees Christ as everything. Colossians 2, 9. "For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily." And we get lost in life, and we lose our direction in life, because we fail to see how great Jesus is and we take our eyes off him. So I'd like to just talk about being connected to the vine, drinking from the vine, obedience in the vine, difficulties in the vine, and blessings in the vine. Connected to the vine, drinking from the vine, obedience in the vine, difficulties in the vine, and blessings in the vine. Here we have a picture. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth, that it may bring forth more fruit. So the idea is that it's a vine of grapes. And there are the grapes hanging off the branches, and the branches are in the main stem. And the Lord's saying, "I'm the main stem, I'm the heart of the vine. And I want to see you bearing fruit, I want to see you being grapes, having that fruit in your life." And you can't have that fruit unless you're resting in the vine, like the branches are resting in the vine of the grapevine. And that's what the image is all about. So the Lord wants us to bear fruit in our lives. If you look at verse 4, "Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot," here it is, "bear" what? "Fruit of itself. Except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except you abide in me." Verse 5, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much" what? "Fruit. For without me you can do nothing." Verse 8, "In this is my Father glorified, that you" what? "Bear much fruit, so you shall be my disciple." And verse 16, "You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go forth and bring forth" what? "Fruit, that your fruit should remain, and that whatever you shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you." The Lord wants you to bear fruit today in your life. He wants you to bear fruit. But how do we bear fruit? How do we grow in Christ? How do we develop in Christ? How do we bear fruit in Christ? Well, if you look at Romans chapter 1, verse 17, it says this: "For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, The just shall live by faith. That's how we bear fruit. We bear fruit by faith in Christ, by trusting in Christ. Romans 5:17. For if by one man's obedience death reigned by one, much more by which received abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign by one, Jesus Christ. And you could read Romans 6 verse 10 and 11. But we bear fruit by faith in Christ. We bear fruit also, if you turn to Acts chapter 2 verse 41. Acts chapter 2 verse 41, 47. We read these words. It says, Acts 2, 41, 47, how we bear fruit in Jesus. It says, then they gladly received the word, were baptized the same day, and were added unto them about 3,000. They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking the bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together, and all things common, and sold the possession of goods, and parted them to all men, as every man had need. And they continued daily in the temple one accord, breaking bread from house to house, to eat their food with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favour with all people. But there's some lessons there. Verse 31, they received the word. We grow in the vine by receiving the word of God. Verse 42, and they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. We grow in Christ if we focus on sound doctrine, sound teaching. It says, breaking of bread, we grow when we meet for the Lord's Supper and we remember what Christ has done for us. We grow when we have fellowship. It says, and they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, breaking of bread and prayer. But fellowship when we meet together as God's people. We grow together and we grow in Christ when we grow in love, verse 45. And sold the possessions of goods and parted them to all men, as every man had need. We grow more as we give more. As we give to people our time and our love, then the Spirit of God will fill us up more. Amen. We grow more as we become disciples. Verse 46, and they continued daily with one accord in the temple, breaking bread house to house, and eat their food with gladness and singleness of heart. But it was daily they continued to follow the Lord. They were disciples of the Lord. And we will grow in Christ if we're disciples of Him, learners of Him. Verse 47, praising God. Praising God. We grow in Christ as we praise, as we worship. That is how to abide in the vine. By abiding in the word, by abiding in sound doctrine, by abiding in the ordinances of God, the preaching of the word, and breaking of bread, by abiding in prayer, by abiding in love, by being a learner, a disciple, and by praising Christ. Those are ways how we abide in the vine and rest in Christ. And as we rest in Christ, God is not a namby-pamby daddy. You know, there are some daddies that the little kids say, daddy, daddy, I want this and I want that, and they get everything they want. Well, God's not like that. God doesn't pander to us. If you look at verse 2, 15 verse 2, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he what? Taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, here it is, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. So God purges us, and sometimes we'll go through difficulties. That is one of the ways God bears fruit in our lives. You won't grow if you don't go through difficulties. Amen. God, why? You say, well, why can't I just have an easy life? Why can't it just be easy? Well, it's because God's pruning you. It's because those difficulties are testing your faith, patience, love. You wouldn't grow if you didn't have those difficulties you had to go through. They're helping you to be pruned. God's not going to just give you everything you want. He's going to take you through difficulties where you have to exercise faith, patience, and love. So it's like a marriage, if you were married or if you are married, and if you never talk to that person, never spend any time with that person, you will not grow in that relationship. And it's the same with Christ. We have to spend time with Him, and that is abiding with Him. We have to want Him more than anything else, and to be with Him daily. Secondly, so that is abiding in the vine, connected to the vine, and then drinking from the vine. If you turn to John 15, verse 9, it says, "As the Father hath loved me, so I have loved you. Continue in my love." So how do we grow? How do we grow in Christ? Well, we drink of the love of God. We drink of the love of God. If you're thirsty, you get a glass of water and you drink that water. So if we're going to grow in Christ, we need to drink in the love of God. John 17, verse 23. If you turn to John 17, 23. Says this, "And the glory which thou gavest me, I give them, that they may be one as we are one." The staggering fact is, in eternity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are wrapped up in glory and love. And when Christ came down and died on the cross, and He saved you, He wants you to be partaker of that glory and of that love that they have in eternity and for all time. And you are brought into that presence of the Trinity. You are brought into that love, that glory. And so you are to be invited to meditate on it and drink of that love for you. It's like the stars. Imagine you look at the stars and you see the stars stretch, and then you see the universe stretch. Well, the love of God goes beyond the stars, beyond the galaxies. The love is so wide, you cannot fathom it. And you have been invited into the love of God through Jesus. So you need to meditate much on the love of God for you. If you turn to Romans 5, verse 1 to 8. Romans 5, verse 1 to 8. We read these words. It says, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into the grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God." What he's saying there is, we're now saved, we're now justified before God, we now share in the glory of God. It says, and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulation, also knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience is experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because here it is, the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, who is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man some would even dare to die. But here it is, but God commendeth his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God has showered his love upon us, and we must rejoice in that and meditate much on it. If you go to Romans 8, chapter 8, it says, verse 35, "What shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creation shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." So when you come back to John chapter 15, and you read those words in verse 9, As the Father hath loved me, so I have loved you, continuing my love. So there, as I have loved you, as I have loved you. So think about what I've just said, the stars, the love of God, and what God has done. Meditate much on the love of God. Thirdly, obedience in the vine. Obedience in the vine. Have you ever had a pet dog? A little puppy. If you just let that little puppy loose in your house and not train that puppy, he's going to do things you're not going to like. He's just going to go all over the place and do things. You've got to train that puppy, and when it grows up to be a full dog, you don't want that dog just doing its own thing, barking at people or whatever. It's got to come under authority, it's got to be obedient to you. And when we become Christians, we kind of, all of us have been trained to think we just clap our hands and dance, and we have a few feelings, a gooey feelings of God, and that's it. But that's not Christianity. Look what Christianity is. Can you see what it is? John 15:10. Is this gooey gooey stuff? Is this gooey gooey feely feely stuff now? But watch this now. Are you ready for this? John 15:10. If you keep my what? Commandments, you shall abide in my love. Even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Do you hear that in the church today? Do you hear this verse 12? This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. But did you notice it's a commandment? We don't like to hear that these days. Verse 13. Greater love of no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Oh, sorry. Verse 14. Ye are my friends, if you do whatever I have commanded you. We're so saturated today in the church with feelings. Oh, I feel this. I feel that I love her. I feel that I'll do this. I feel that I'll do that. Oh, Pastor said, you shouldn't marry that woman. Why, Pastor? Because she doesn't believe in Jesus. She's a Muslim. Yeah, but Pastor, I feel it. I feel it, Pastor. I feel I should marry her. No, Pastor says, no. The Word of God says you should not marry to an unbeliever. That's what the Word of God says. Oh, Pastor, I feel it. I feel it. And that's what everyone's saying today. I feel it. Yeah? But what does he say? Verse 17, John 15:17. These things I command you, that you love one another. Now just turn to 1 John. And Praveen, if you could read these verses when I give it to you. Now just notice this. This is against everything that you're hearing in the church today. Because the church is happy, clappy, gooey, gooey. But listen to this. 1 John chapter 2, verse 3, Praveen, bro.
And we can be sure that we know him if we obey his commands.
If we obey his commands. Verse chapter 2, verse 4.
If someone claims, I know God, but does not obey God's commandments, that person is a liar and is not living in the truth.
Now when did you last hear, I'm not saying here, but when did you last hear in one of these churches, happy clappy, that talk about you must obey the commandments? You don't hear it. We hear be filled in the Spirit and be full of joy, but we don't hear obey the commandments. We don't hear that, because we're so trained to rely on our feelings rather than on the Word of God. 2:5, you just read 1 John 2:5.
But those who obey God's Word truly show how completely they love Him. That is how we know we are living in Him.
Now, if you were to read John, the Gospel of John chapter 4, verse 34, the Lord says, he wants to do the Father's will. And in John 8:29 and John 10:17, all the time the Lord, the Son of God, says, I desire to do the Father's will. So if we're going to abide in the Lord, if we're going to abide in Christ, it's not just relying on our feelings, it's obeying His word.
Amen.
It's obeying His commandments. Like, love is a command, it's not an option. It's, you know, in Praveen White's Beyond sentence today, he says something and he does me any. And I think, I don't like Praveen anymore, I've had enough of him. No, it's commanded that I love him. It's a command. Love is not an option. I can't say, I don't love him. I have to love him. I'm commanded to. But we all bear grudges, don't we? People wind us up and we bear grudges to them and we're commanded to love. Leon Warren says, it is not some mystical experience. It is simple obedience. It is when we keep Christ's commandments that we abide in His love. Amen. It is not some mystical experience. It is simple obedience. It is when we keep Christ's commandments that we abide in His love. So those who want to go into the heights of the Spirit, those who want to really go into the heights of God and feel His power and joy, and the Spirit of God come down, the ones who obey the word are going to experience those things. If Praveen obeys the word, he's going to be on fire and moving in the Spirit. Yeah? If I obey the word and follow the word, then I'll move in the Spirit. But we put it the other way around. We think we could just move in the Spirit and not be obedient to the word. So I'll read it again. It is not some mystical experience. It is simple obedience. It is when we keep Christ's commandments that we abide in His love, Leon Morris. Difficulties in the vine. So if we go to John 15, if you read chapter 15, verse 18, chapter 15, verse 18. If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If the world hated you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. Amen. So, Christianity, when you come to know Jesus, and you say, Jay, I love being with Jesus, it is great. And then a few weeks later, you're having a bad time at work, people are mocking you, people are getting on your nerves. Even someone at the church has been backstabbing you, really nasty towards you. And then you come up to me and say, yeah, I've had enough of this. I've had enough because I follow Jesus and I'm just getting stick at work and I'm even getting stick by Christians and I'm fed up of it. I'm off. I'm going joining Islam. I'm sick of this. I'm sick of it. What does he say? What does he say? Verse 18. If the world hated you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. Verse 19. If you were of the world would love its own, but because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world, what? Hated you.
Amen.
Verse 20. Remember the word that I said unto you. The servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep you also. They will keep yours also. These people who want to, hate the world, they put rock music on. I'm not against rock music or anything. But they try to hate the world. They put, nightclub music in evangelism. I mean, everybody might, you might think it's great, but the point what I'm trying, I'm not saying it's wrong or whatever, but what I'm saying is, they put this nightclub music on to do evangelism. So you go, yo man, right? You've got this rap music going, right? And then they're dressing dead cool, yo man, I'm rapping today for you. We got the rap music, we look like a rapper. I'm not saying it's wrong, but what I'm saying is they think that everybody's going to like them because they're doing it. But what's it say here? Remember the law that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. Paul didn't turn up into Ephesus. Apostle Paul turns up and says, yo, I'm the Apostle Paul. What happened to him? They kicked him, punched him, and he was thrown outside the city. Our Lord didn't go into Jerusalem, start rapping, did he? Did he? What happened? They crucified him.
Amen.
So I'm not saying it's wrong to do that. All I'm saying is the church tries to aid the world so that the world will like them. But the world's never going to like them. We're going to get